How do we want to say this? Occupants of a taxi cab in Santa Barbara, California, last December, and in broad daylight, were suddenly surrounded by what would have to be described as the appearance of a SWAT team of police, all of whom were armed. The taxi was abruptly halted, and all three men were ordered out of the cab, whereupon they were spread-eagled, handcuffed, and were you... They didn't use dirty words, did they?
No, they were very nice about speaking to us. But they had a megaphone. They were talking to it on a megaphone. And they just literally told us to go toward the middle of the street and lie face down.
In the middle of the street?
Right.
You must have thought that this... what did you think?
Well, when we heard the siren, the taxi cab pulled over, and I was waiting on the police car to come by. But it never came by.
You mean this was an unmarked car?
Right, it was an unmarked car. And I looked over my right shoulder and saw a guy pushing the door open of a beige car, sticking a pistol out the window. And I took a double take and looked back, and I saw some guys pumping shotguns at us.
By popping, you mean cocking?
Yes, pumping.
Pumping. You must have freaked.
I'm telling you, Ursie, I was scared to death because I knew I hadn't done anything. I was sitting in the back seat with Jim. And I just freaked out, basically, because I didn't know why these people had these guns on me.
You heard, obviously, a guy with several fellows with shotguns and a megaphone. You're going to do whatever it is that they desire you to do at that moment.
Well, before they said anything, my hands were in there. Before they had a chance to say anything.
You had to lie face down in the middle of the street?
Well, they asked us to. They told me the white line, for some reason, the white line was moving when I got out of the car. I could not find it. I was just that nervous, and I was just that, I was in another land because we hadn't done anything, and the car was stopped, and we were asked to get out and to lie face down with the Super Eagle, and it was just a very frightening experience.
How long would you say this, what was the duration of the time that the car was stopped and the recognition that this was a case of mistaken identity?
About a half hour to 45 minutes.
Let me try and fill this audience in. Apparently, earlier that day, a jeweler in the area had been relieved of $400,000 worth of merchandise against his will. The jeweler described the assailants to police. The description he offered the assailants was certainly in no way consistent with the way that you look, except that the people alleged to have been responsible for the actual jewelry heist were black. How tall are you, Jimmy?
That's Jimmy.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I'm 6 foot two.
You're Jimmy.
Yes, sir.
Obi?
6'5".
And Luke?
6'10".
You're 6'10"?
Right.
What was the description of the jewelry store?
Average height, about 5'6", 5'7".
Average height was 5'7 to 5'6 to 5'9, I think it was.
So now the jeweler shows up, the man that was victimized at the robbery. He takes one look at you and says, no way.
Yeah, they had us to get out of the police car. They all put us all in separate police cars so we can communicate with each other, I guess. And they had Jimmy to get out first, and he looked at Jimmy. Then he went back to the back car where Ovi was, and they looked at Ovi. And then finally, I climbed out of the back of the police car, and he shook his head and said no.
Did the police apologize to you?
Well, I'd say maybe the next day after all the pressure was on the guy, we got a call. The media put pressure on the police to apologize to us. It was not, I mean, how can you apologize when you have someone's life in your hands? I mean, at the point they had the gun on us.
Well, I mean, after it was revealed that you weren't the folks.
Well, I got a call for the police chief, supposedly, Santa Barbara. This is like 20 minutes before we were leaving the city the next day. And that was about 3 in the afternoon. So I guess he had all day to really memorize what he had to say. And he called me and said that his direct words were, quote unquote, I hope that you and your teammates don't have any ill feelings about our fun city, a fine city of Santa Barbara, and that I want to congratulate you for cooperating with the police. And I said, well, just a second. I said, we didn't have any choice to cooperate. He said, well, you know, it could have been worse. And I says, well, I'll see you in court. And that was the bulk of the conversation.
So at first you were frightened, not surprisingly. Then you were relieved, and then you were angry.
That's right.
And you are bringing really a good deal of celebrity power to an issue which is from San Francisco to New York, finding its way into media as well as court with increasing frequency. The allegation is that more and more minority citizens are being stopped by police officer, and without necessarily commenting on the behavior of all police officers, it is not misleading or overstated to say that a number of those officers are in effect saying, shut up, we're taking you in. The police, the minority community is obviously enraged by what they perceive to be racist action on the part of police. The police are responding by saying we have an obligation to protect the citizens, and while we don't condone the action of all police officers, if enough people sue, the hands of the police officers are tied, and we can't protect the citizens from harm, either within their own communities or from people on the outside. I don't know if anybody wants to speak to that,